Hi, today I will compare the pros and cons of all the major cryopreservation techniques, and not only cryopreservation techniques, but also other types of preservation. The main ones are vitrification-based cryopreservation, chemical fixation without any cryopart, and ASC, aldehyde stabilized cryopreservation. And then last but not least, technically some people of course are currently preserved. We are just straight freeze, where you just don't do anything, you just cool down the body to cryogenic temperatures. It's going to be a tremendous amount of ice formation and so on. This one, we're not really comparing because there's only downsides, there's no upsides. It's like a last ditch effort, would never recommend it. So we're going to focus on the three main types of preservation techniques. Starting with the one where at least most people who are cryopreserved today have been cryopreserved with. This is vitrification-based preservation. In this case, you use a cryoprotective agent, that is a glass former. Then when you cool down the body or the brain to cryogenic temperatures, at some point you cross the so-called glass transition temperature, at which temperature the tissue goes into this glass-like amorphous state, meaning the vitrified state. At that temperature, you have then achieved vitrification-based preservation. The advantages of that are that no protein gets cross-linked, meaning the tissue is as close as possible, of course, assuming there is no damage, as it would be in while it's alive. This is also the technique that has been used to preserve kidneys or other small organs, which then enabled them, once you devitrify the organ, it was usable again. So you remain viability. This is one of the main advantages. Arguably, there's also the most amount of experience in human preservation with this type of technique, because it was done for probably almost all the cases that have been preserved so far, assuming it wasn't a straight freeze. Now, the downsides of this technique is that the quality of preservation under certain circumstances is probably worse than with other preservation mechanisms or techniques that we'll talk about in a second. Nevertheless, if you have a low ischemic case and you have a team that is well trained for vitrification-based preservation, then cryopreservation via vitrification is definitely a good option. It might also in the future make it slightly easier to revive someone, to bring someone back from cryopreservation without, you know, super complex technology, even though under most circumstances, very advanced nanotechnology would be required to fix damage that has been accumulated during the cryopreservation procedure or before that if there was any relevant amount of ischemic time. The second technique would be chemical fixation. In chemical fixation, the method of preservation is basically a cross-linking of all the proteins and so on in the cell into basically one, in quotation marks, unit, which then allows preservation where nothing moves anymore, there's no degradation anymore, and so on and so on. With that, you can either, and actually it's not only either or, it's you can do either option or a combination of both. You can perfuse tissue or the brain, for argument's sake, with a chemical fixative, which then would chemically fix all the brain. You can also put the brain into this fixative solution, where you would then have a diffusion of that fixative into the tissue, which would again lead to a fixed brain. Or you do a combination of both. You do perfusion-based fixation and you do immersion-based fixation at the same time. Now, this is definitely a technique that has some advantages. So one of the advantages, for example, being it's very, very affordable. So the fixative is relatively cheap. And since it's fixed, it does not require low temperatures. So you do not need to maintain cryogenic temperatures. So you could technically do it at, you know, 4 degrees or even room temperature, for argument's sake. The downsides are that these fixatives are usually relatively toxic. Not necessarily to the tissue, because, you know, everything is cross-linked anyway, so the word toxic in that sense doesn't make that much sense. But it's also toxic to the people who do it. You need to have, you know, good ventilation and so on and so on. So it's slightly more difficult to use in a, you know, practical sense, in a day-to-day sense. There's some indication that for very long storage durations, there's still some amount of change in the tissue, so-called lipid drift, for example, where lipids are not well fixed, because it's mostly cross-linked proteins, then there would still be a movement on the cell membrane, for example. It's not fully decided if this is a big risk over long periods, but at least there might be smaller degree of stability for very long periods than, for example, if you would compare it with vitrification-based cryopreservation. Another disadvantage is that in cases where there's a relevant amount of ischemia, where you would have blood clotting already in the vessels. Now, if you perfuse that chemical fixative, there's some indication that this would cross-link now blood cells, which would then have a harder time squeezing through the small vessels and getting out of the body, where you might get lower preservation quality as opposed to if you would try to preserve with a vitrification-based preservation technique, and where, of course, in this case, you would perfuse cryoprotective agent, which doesn't have that cross-linking function. Last but not least, there is a combination of chemical fixation and cryopreservation. Most famously, aldehyde stabilized cryopreservation, or ASC. In this type of preservation, you try to use the best of both worlds, meaning you would start first with a chemical fixation, in this case with an aldehyde. In this case, you do basically exactly what you would do in a chemical fixation. And then once you've done that, in the second step, you perfuse with a cryoprotective agent and then cool down to cryogenic temperatures. In this case, you have the advantages of good quality ultrastructure preservation of chemical fixation, plus the long-term stability of preservation that you gain with vitrification-based methods. The downsides are similar to what you would see in chemical fixation, even though you don't have the problem of long-term potential instability due to lipid drifts and so on, but you still have the problem of these practical issues that the chemical fixative is toxic, needs to be done quick, directly after circulatory arrest, basically, because it handles small amounts of ischemia worse than in the case of cryopreservation. So these are the three main methods of preservation: vitrification-based preservation, what is usually called cryopreservation, chemical fixation, or a combination of the two, aldehyde stabilized cryopreservation. Most organizations, as I mentioned, are currently using vitrification-based methodology. And then under certain circumstances, us and others go for other types of preservation. One of the examples is if we have a case where there's a very high degree of ischemia. In this case, it is very difficult to do vitrification-based preservation. In fact, if you would now try to perfuse with a cryoprotective agent, there would be a more negative downside due to damage than there would be upsides. So in this case, for example, we switch to an immersion-based fixation, which doesn't have the problem of perfusion. We basically do diffusion into the tissue. We do this for a while, and then tissue would be fixed, and you can still do preservation with a vitrification agent, with a cryoprotective agent after. And now you have this combination of vitrification and fixation, vitrofixation. In parts of this video, I talked about what different types of revival might be the necessary solution for different types of preservation. If you want to learn more about how revival might work in principle, take a look at this video over here, where we talk about exactly that topic. If you want to reach out to us and discuss any other topic, feel free to leave a comment below, or go to tomorrow.bio and reach out to us in person. We're more than happy to discuss one-on-one. Talk to you soon.